Happy Thanksgiving. It's so good to be together. Why don't we stand up together and just sing? This is kind of an anthem. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given Jesus Christ, His Son. He's given Jesus Christ, His Son. Camilla, would you just open us in prayer?
Thank you, Lord, for this day. We give you praise. We welcome your presence. We just love you today. Thank you, Lord, for Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Father. Thank you for everyone in the room. Thank you for our families. Thank you for this nation. Lord, we give you praise, Father. We give you the highest praise today. Today is a good day to give God the highest praise. Amen. Hallelujah.
And now let the weak say, song, as I often do.
trusted.
Oh, you never.
And you never do. So I throw up my hands, praise you again and again. 'Cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, but I've nothing else fit for a king, except for a heart singing. You got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord.
Look at somebody and say, praise the Lord.
Come on, my soul. Don't you get shy on me. Lift up your song. 'Cause you got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. Throw up my hands and praise you again. All that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, but I'm nothing else fit for a king, except for a heart singing hallelujah, hallelujah. I've got one response. I'm responding this way. I've got just one mood. With my arms stretched wide, I will worship you. I've got one response. I've got one response. I've got just one mood. With my arms stretched wide, I will. So I throw up my hands, praise you again and again. 'Cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, but I'm nothing else fit for a king, except for a heart. Joining in heaven's song. I will worship you.
This is a brand new song. Remember 2 weeks ago, I told you the Lord gave it to me. I've been praying and kind of getting it through, but it comes right from the book of Revelation. It tells the story of what's happening around the throne of God. The song's titled, The Lord and the Lamb. I sent it to all the worship team this week, and they just started learning the lion and the lamb. Our God is a lion, but that's not this one. But we can sing that too. The Lord and the Lamb. You'll have to look it up in Revelation, because I've tried to just write the song just as the story unfolds. The story unfolds with all the people from every nation and every tribe. People that had been bought by the blood of the Lamb, coming to worship before the throne. And then it turns to the angels circling around the throne with the elders and the four living creatures, singing salvation belongs to our God on the throne. So I'm going to teach you. This song's a little challenging, but I think it's going to be worth it. Because what's going to happen is, because there's three different people's group worshiping, three different people's group are singing a different song unto the Lord and the Lamb. The first group are the nations and tribes that are already in heaven. And their part goes like this. Quentin, help me. Salvation belongs to our God on his throne. Salvation belongs to the Lamb. Salvation belongs to our God on his throne. We worship the Lord. Let's do that a couple times. Salvation belongs to our God on his throne. Salvation belongs to the Lamb. Salvation belongs to our God on his throne. We worship Lord and the Lamb. Come on, look at somebody and say, that's not too bad. All right, now this is what the angels and the elders and the four living beasts say. Here goes. Blessing and glory and majesty, splendor and power and might, wisdom and honor and thanksgiving, we worship the Lord and the Lamb. Here we go. Blessing and glory and majesty, splendor and power and might, wisdom and honor and thanksgiving, we worship the Lord and the Lamb. Now just for fun, I'm going to have Chris and Randa sing that first part, and we're going to sing the blessing, glory, and honor. You ready? Blessing and glory and majesty, splendor and power and might, wisdom and honor and thanksgiving, we worship the Lord and the Lamb. Do it again. Blessing and honor and majesty, splendor and power and might, wisdom and honor and thanksgiving, we worship the Lord and the Lamb. Come on, give yourself a big hand. That's good, that's good, that's good. Now, if you're like me, it's sometimes hard to chew gum and walk at the same time, right? Now, this is from us, the people of God who've been bought by the blood, still are here on the earth to worship. It goes like this. Forever and ever we worship the Lord and the Lamb. Forever, amen, we worship the Lord and the Lamb. Forever and ever we worship the Lord and the Lamb. Forever, amen, we worship the Lord and the Lamb. Are you ready to sing it now? Here's the first verse. Victorious ones from every tribe, every nation, and every tongue, they were gathered around the Lord and the Lamb. With branches from palms in every hand, all wearing glistening white robes, making glorious sounds before heaven's throne. Salvation belongs to our God on his throne. Salvation belongs to the Lamb. Salvation belongs to our God on his throne. We worship the Lord and the Lamb. Salvation. Salvation. angels.
All the angels were standing and circling round the elders and four living beasts. They all fell face down before heaven's throne. Blessing and glory and majesty, splendor and power and might, wisdom and glory and thanksgiving, we worship the Lord and the Lamb. Blessing and glory and majesty, splendor and power and might, wisdom and honor and thanksgiving, we worship the Lord.
One more time.
Blessing and glory and majesty, splendor and power and might, wisdom and honor and thanksgiving, we worship the Lord and the Lamb.
Come on, somebody lift up a shout of worship.
The Lamb was sent from heaven to earth, for God so loved the world. With shouts of praise, we join heaven's song. Forever and ever, we worship the Lord and the Lamb. Forever, amen, we worship the Lord. Blessing and glory and majesty, splendor and power and might, wisdom and honor and thanksgiving, we worship the Lord and the Lamb.
Forever and ever.
Forever and ever, we worship the Lord and the Lamb. Forever and ever, we worship the Lord.
Say on earth as it is in heaven. That's what we want, God. Bring the worship down from heaven. Bring the heavenly host down to sing. We join with the elders and the angels. We're singing, salvation belongs to our God. We're giving you blessing and glory and majesty. We declare your splendor and power and might, wisdom and honor. Thanksgiving. Everybody say thanksgiving.
We worship the Lord and the Lamb. We worship the Lord and the Lamb. We worship the Lord and the Lamb.
We're going to do it in the Mexican tradition, Acapulco. Camilla, you're going to sing the blessing and glory and honor with... You're going to do that part. You guys are going to do the splendor, and we're going to do the forever and ever, all of us. Put the forever and ever up there for us. Are you ready? One, two.
Blessing and glory.
You come in on salvation.
Majesty.
Wait. And don't go that slow. One, two. Salvation
belongs to our God on his throne. Salvation belongs to the Lamb. Salvation belongs to our God on his throne. We worship the Lord and the Lamb. Salvation belongs to our God forever and ever. For worship the Lord and the Lamb. Salvation belongs to our God forever and ever. We worship the Lord and the Lamb.
One more time.
Salvation belongs to our God
forever and ever.
We worship the Lord. Salvation belongs to our God on his throne. We worship the Lord and the Lamb. blessing and glory and majesty, splendor and power and might, wisdom and honor and thanksgiving. We worship the Lord and the Lamb.
Come on, sing it forever.
Forever and ever we worship the Lord and the Lamb.
It reminds me of another song.
Forever and ever we worship the Lord and the Lamb. Worship the Lord and the Lamb, King of kings and Lord of lords. We worship the Lord and the Lamb, King of kings and Lord of lords. We worship the Lord and the Lamb, King of kings.
Come on, all time, all parts, here we go. Feel like you've had a workout.
All that going on in his head.
I know. That's why I couldn't sleep last night.
Yeah. It's just a lot.
I just want you to know God's trying to give us all a revelation of where he's taking us in worship.
Hallelujah.
I felt like the Holy Spirit said, Stephen, we've got to get off the page. Too many people are still just reading note to note and word to word. But worship is supposed to be from the heart. So the notes and the words are to help get our hearts into a place to ascend and worship. Amen. And the Bible says sing a new song. I think ultimately as we get off the page, we just begin to sing what God puts in our heart. We begin to sing sometimes in English, sometimes in another language. Amen. Amen.
Gathered at the highest throne, welcomed by a melody, an anthem I have always known, a song that's always been in me. All glory and honor, dominion and power to you. A million angels fall, holy is the Lord. My heart can't help but sing with all the heaven roar. Forever and holy is the Lord. Oh, oh, oh. Forever and holy is the Lord. Oh, oh, oh. Forever and holy. Joining in the symphony, all glory and honor, dominion and power to you. All wisdom and wonder belong to no other but you. A million angels fall face down on the floor. Sing with all of heaven's roar, forever and belong to no other but you. A million angels fall face down on the floor, all to echo, holy is the Lord. My heart can't help but sing with all of heaven's roar. Forever echo, holy is
a million angels.
A million angels fall face down on the floor.
The song starts out with the lyric, just a crumb from your table, or just a drop. And I want you to know the truth of that is that's all it takes. It's just one touch, just something. But I've got such good news for you. No good thing will he withhold from you. He's not just giving his children crumbs. Amen. The lady said to Jesus, the crumbs are for the dogs. We're not dogs. We're sons and daughters. Amen. We're sons and daughters. So, Lord, we're coming to you because you have exactly what we want and everything we need. Give us this day our daily bread. Somebody just lift up your hands and say, give me today my daily bread.
Just a crumb from your table. Just a drop from your well. It's all that I desire. Enough to fulfill. But you welcome the hungry, the weary, and the least to a river of life, to a heavenly feast.
Today, the worshiping today.
Holy, holy is the Lord, the one who has saved us, who is with us. Just a glimpse of your glory, just the sound of your voice can shatter the darkness, silence the noise. But I'll soon shine in brilliance of an overwhelming light, and I'll join the sound of
imagine what a day that will be when we're singing with the angels.
Holy, holy is.
saved us.
The one who has saved us, who is with us and made a way. Holy is the Lord. Holy is the Lord.
Because you're the one.
You are the one who was and is to come, will be forevermore. We are the grateful ones, daughters and sons, we're yours forevermore. You are the one who was and is to come, will be forevermore. We are the grateful ones, daughters and sons, we're yours forevermore. You are the one.
Generation is singing the same song.
Holy is the Lord. Holy, holy is the Lord.
Come on, just let it come out of your heart and mouth today. Holy,
holy
are you, Lord.
Holy are you, Lord. Holy.
Salvation belongs to our God on His temple. Salvation belongs to the Lamb.
worship the Lord and the Lamb. We worship the Lord and the Lamb. We worship the Lord and the Lamb.
Woo! Can you see every tribe, every nation, every tongue gathering around the Lord and the Lamb? Can you see the angels circling around the throne with the elders bowing down, the four living creatures worshiping? Salvation belongs to the Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Yes.
Salvation belongs to our God.
Thank you, Lord.
We need to be crying that out today in our circumstances. Amen.
Yes.
When it looks like everything's going the wrong direction, we just cry out, salvation belongs to our God.
Yes, thank you,
Lord. On his throne. He's still on his throne.
Thank you for salvation.
Salvation belongs to the Lamb. His blood will never lose its power.
Salvation
belongs to our God on the throne. We worship the Lord.
Salvation, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Blessing and glory and majesty, splendor and power and might, wisdom and honor and
happy Thanksgiving, Abba. Happy Thanksgiving, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Happy Thanksgiving, Holy Spirit.
Yes. We thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
We worship the Lord and the Lamb. We worship the Lord and the Lamb.
Hallelujah. I felt like the angels today were like those Celtic angels. They're dancing around like all kinds of stuff, you know. And then we got a few cowboy angels in there because they kind of come from the Celtic, you know. They're dancing. They're all dancing. They're all worshiping. And we're just joining in with the worship that's in heaven. And, you know, I love the songs that we sing that are declaration songs, because that has been such strength to us, especially in the last few years. Fear is not my future. You are. Sickness is not my story. You are. On and on. Those are an amazing declarations that we need. But I am excited about the worship that is returning to the house of the Lord, because it's pure, it's clean, it's unto the Lord. And we are not coming to get anything, we're coming to give. But God is so good, we get so much. But he's preparing us for heaven. He's preparing us for heaven on earth. He's preparing us for glory. He's preparing us to just be worshiping and praising the Lord when people are coming to Jesus, when people are getting healed, when people are getting set free and delivered all at the same time. He can do that. Yes, he can. Yesterday, I had told Stephen, I said, I'm going to go into my prayer room, because I just, for several years, it's been very difficult for me to be just like that. You know, I had a hard time going to the chapel and just being alone, period. And so I just felt like I'm, you know, walking into such freedom. Like, I'm going into my room and I'm going to soak and I'm going to worship and I'm just going to give my afternoon to the Lord. And so that was like, okay, he was working on something. And we're having some work done outside on our deck. And so I happened to be like right next to the deck. I'm like, oh, I didn't think about that. You know, they're working and their saws are going. And then, you know, didn't we tell you about our little robot that I'm in love, you know, Riho? Well, I call him Riho named him Riho off of Rehoboth Ranch. But he was having a few issues. He started having, you know, being paused and saying, I need you to come get me and pick me up and put me back in the right place. I'm like, what in the world? Riho, I can't do this. I can't have my eyes on this, you know, my app. And then Mr. started up on the piano. So, exactly. Like, Oh my goodness. And I'm laying there going, okay, there's Saws out on the back. There's Riho that keeps getting paws and I have to go pick him up. Steven's in there banging on the piano. And here I am, Jesus. Like, I'm really trying to go up to the third heaven here. And I just know you have something for me. So, it is possible to worship in this life. It's possible to give him all of our praise in the midst of the crazy, crazy world, right? And so, even if you feel like I am so distracted, but I came to worship, I don't know what you came to do. Come on. I don't know what you came to do. Tell your neighbor, neighbor. I'm taking this. If you didn't come to praise the Lord, I ain't never sitting by you again. This is it. I came to praise the Lord. Even in the crazy, crazy, we're here to worship God. And let me just tell you, he loves our worship. And he is just so like, woo, excited and is receiving it. And he's releasing breakthrough and peace and joy and strength and everything every one of us needs all at the same time, which is really amazing. We have such an amazing God. So anyway, like Stephen said, happy Thanksgiving to every one of you. And first, I want to just say how wonderful Tuesday night was. This was the trafficking night just for us to have an awareness. And it was amazing. Dawn, you're here today. Dawn and Sherry, it's great to see you all today. And it was really, really great. And I want to say what an amazing turnout from all of you. Bethesda, we had a great turnout. And even some of you that live long, you know, out, you came. And then we've shared the live stream so that you can keep listening if you didn't make it and you can share with others. We're bringing that awareness. And I know that we've gone to the four corners and we've gone to the hotels. We've prayed. We've walked around the little convenience stores. And we're going to continue doing that. And we're going to do that again after the first of the year. We're mobilizing and praying Holy Spirit just to give us fresh direction for what he wants for now. And so I'm excited about that. And if you personally, you like, wow, because Barb, she really got something that we were supposed to do last time. And that really just thrust us out a few months ago. But if you have something from the Lord, you just share that with Joy or myself. And we're excited to mobilize and know that our prayers are powerful and they are making a difference. Amen. You know, it wasn't an accident. Literally 2 weeks or a week, actually it was a week after we had gone to the four corners up here at I-20 and 69 and we prayed and we blew the shofar and we did all the crazy, great stuff. I think it was Richard Moran, he shared, he saw this a video, a news that one of the largest houses for making meth was blown up, busted. Yeah, confiscated, shut down, and oh my goodness, that's all it took was, you know, we all saw that, like 1 week, we're like, yeah, God, you did it, you know, from your prayers and the prayers that have come before us and the prayers of God's people, so we're going to continue to do that, and it's exciting. One more thing I'm going to just share with you, and then we're going to just welcome those and move forward, but We're mobilizing, we're activating, we're seeing this army, this mighty army, be raised up in a fresh way, and you're activated already, but we're excited about seeing this activation here at the end of the year, and at the first of the year, we're going to be announcing and having some meetings for you to be active in serving here at Bethesda, and not only, you know, you might sign up to be a greeter, but you're going to be a Holy Spirit anointed greeter. You're going to prophesy. You're going to do all this stuff, right? I'm looking at my grandbaby. Every time I have him, I say, you are anointed and appointed to preach the word of the Lord. In that voice, yes. He's anointed and appointed to preach the word of the Lord. And you see all the angels around and you are just filled with the Holy Spirit. And so we speak that over one another. You are anointed and appointed to preach the word of the Lord. So just be watching. We're having a meeting today for one of our ministry teams, and we're just excited. So we will have next Sunday, hopefully, all of the opportunities to celebrate in December. Can you believe it's already, that time has come? Should I ask for a show of hands? How many of you have your trees up already? I know it. Come on, Susie, Jane. I have one tree up. Come on, for the people to have their trees up. This is exciting. Well, we bless you, and we're just excited about this holiday season, and we get to worship together, and we get to have time together. I know for some of you, it will be a time that you're walking by faith because you've lost a family member and things have changed in your life, and we just pray healing, peace, and restoration in this time.
One thing I love about the Holy Spirit is while there's so much to rejoice about, He also gives us a compassion and a sensitivity in these seasons to remember those that are hurting. Remember those that have need. Amen? God is constantly looking over and taking care of you, and I are His vessels. Many times we're His vessels of love. So I just want to encourage you. You know, in the past as a church, we have done some things together at Thanksgiving, feeding people, giving. We support our food pantry, you through your tithes and offerings. We support our food pantry. We've fed people. We've helped people. And Christmas in the past, we've had campaigns. In fact, yesterday they had the car show with the Tots toys and Tots. And, you know, last year I took two of my cars, and one of them was my Ford truck, and we loaded up the back of that truck. And they told us at the Toys for Tots last year that Bethesda gave the most toys from one group last year. I think we gave like 70 toys. But we've kind of let this year sneak up on us, and there's been a lot of things going on. But I just want to stand before you today and say, don't let your compassion and your heart of love, don't let it be idle at this time. Amen? At this time especially, remember the poor. Remember those that are in prison. Tom, we're excited. We're going to go with you to the prison in December. And we're going to be able to love on those that are incarcerated and tell them, you're free in Jesus. Jesus loves you. And by grace, we are saved, not of our works, lest any one of us could brag and boast about it. Camille and I were getting a phone call yesterday, and Camille told me today, I can't believe I said yes. We're going to be getting online at 7 a.m. in the morning. That's easy for me. It'll be a miracle. Everybody reach out to Camille and say, help her, Lord. We're going to get online to a Zoom call, and we're going to be preaching the gospel to how many people? 2,000? 2,000 people in Pakistan. Pakistan. Preaching the gospel. And I can't wait. My mother used to tell me, and this is when I was pastoring or traveling and singing as an evangelist. My mother said, she'd say, you're an evangelist. You're an evangelist. And I will tell you this, there is nothing in my life that is more exciting than to see somebody come to Jesus. Nothing is more precious. When I watch sports, when somebody says, I give Jesus Christ my Lord and Savior, thanks and praise, I just explode. It's better than the trophy. It's the glory to the Lord that I look for and that I want to give. I know you do too. But back to what I'm saying, we're not doing anything corporately, but let me just encourage you, please, go before the Lord and ask Him, what can I do at Thanksgiving? Invite somebody. There's plenty of people that don't have anywhere to go. Invite them to come over. I was just reading in my message today, part of the scripture was talking in 1 Peter, which I'm actually not going to read it, but I love it, when Peter said, if invite people into your home and feed them. It's just a part of pure, true Christianity. Amen. is the generosity and the love that we express. So invite people to your house, invite them over, feed them, take them to eat. You know, I think one of the greatest tools of evangelism on Sunday is to invite somebody to go to lunch and say, by the way, let's go to church first, and then I'll take you to lunch, right? Oh, nobody thought that was funny. I thought that was funny. They're like, well, okay, if you take me to Cracker Barrel, I'll go to church. You're just going to take me to McDonald's, I'm out. Amen. So I'm looking around and wondering if there's anyone here for the very first time. I don't know that there is, but we just say, somebody might be watching for the first time. We welcome people to come in and be a part of the House of Bethesda. Amen. The House of Bethesda is the house of loving kindness. It's the place of his presence. It's where we prioritize his kingdom first, seek first his kingdom and his righteousness. Amen. I want to say, Celeste, I love you. We love you. We're so glad you're here today, and we pray grace and blessing over your life. Amen. Sheila, always so good to see you. Not that long ago now, a year that Larry went to heaven. I was thinking when I was writing these songs, we already have. We have Dee Dee, we have Larry, we have several from our own church family that are now in glory, in heaven, worshiping on the other side. And when I can hear them, because I lean in to try to hear them, they say, man, it just gets better and better. Covered up my mic. It just gets better and better. It just gets better and better. Have you ever had a meal or something in your life that was so good you actually thought, it just doesn't get any better than this? Yeah. Well, it does. It's getting better every day. Somebody a long time ago got a revelation and wrote it in a song. Every day with Jesus is sweeter than the day before. This is my Baptist roots coming up. Every day with Jesus, I love him more and more. Jesus saves and keeps me, and he's the one I'm living for. Every day with Jesus. Come on, Chris, help me with the harmony. It's sweeter than the day before. I love him. I love him because he first loved me. Okay, I could go down that road. I pulled out that glory, glory at the very end. I cut my teeth on songs like that. And you'll never convince me that what we had in the 70s, 80s, 90s, even in 2000, wasn't wonderful for its day. But it gets better. It gets better. I'm not going to live in the 70s. I met somebody, Francis, at your wonderful birthday party. I want to say happy birthday to Francis Reinhardt. Oh, we love you. And we just are so thankful for you entering your ninth decade. She doesn't mind. In fact, she's excited about it. And I'm excited for you. I only say, Lord, help me to get there one day. But we were at your house, and I met one of the ladies, one of your friends, and they go to Mount Sylvan. I talked to them about you and Keith, and they know Kent, Keith's father. And they were saying, we just love Mount Sylvan because we love the hymns. And I didn't go, oh, really? I said, I do too. I love the hymns. She said, do y'all sing hymns in your church? I said, sometimes. Holy, holy, holy. See, I couldn't be a liar. I had to do something today. But I told her, I said, I love the hymns. I look back to the hymns. And I look and I see the depth of theology and revelation in these hymns. Can you imagine Martin Luther pinning the words, a mighty bulwark is our God? Amen? So I'm never going to say we're better than, no. But here we are, and what God is doing now is sweet. And it's getting better and better and better. Amen? I'm still preaching today. This doesn't count. All right, ushers, come on up. Chris, I'm going to get you to take the microphone and pray a Thanksgiving offering today. Because everything that we have actually belongs to the Lord. I know I'm preaching to the choir today. I'm not manipulating you because you all believe. You believe that everything you have comes from the Lord. Every good and perfect gift comes from the Father of lights. Amen? Everything we have is His. So at Thanksgiving, we need to remember that with a grateful heart, we give back to God to help build and establish what He's doing, what His kingdom is doing, what's on His mind, what's on His heart. I guarantee you, I'm going to say this, it's going to sound funny. God wants to spend your money different than you do.
That's right. Yes.
And it's not a bad thing, but God doesn't need your money for tacos. We do. I need money for tacos, don't you? But what you give to God, and I want to remind you, what you give in the offering is God's. And what you give to God, I believe He will multiply and utilize 100-fold, 100% that God will maximize. So always, listen, if I could just say from my heart, always give something. I've been in times when I didn't have a job, I didn't have an income, didn't have a salary. But whenever I was in church, I wanted to have something. Even if it was a quarter or a nickel, I remember giving a nickel in the offering. And it's what I found on the ground. Some of you probably never been that, you know, tight. And maybe some of you have. But my God shall supply all of our needs. When He sees your grateful heart and your faith in Him to give, it's not an issue for God to take care of you. Remember that old hymn, His eye is on, this is when I need an organ player, the sparrow, and I know He watches me. Leon, I'm looking at you, tell you He knows every hair on your head and every hair that was on your head. Amen. We love you, Beverly. You're getting better and better every day in Jesus' name. All right, Chris.
So, Father, we just thank You, Lord, that You are good and Your mercy endures forever, Lord. And we just give this morning with thanksgiving, Lord, that You provide everything that we have need of, Lord, that You have provided so many times over and over and over again. So, Lord, we just thank You, Lord. And, Lord, as we give today, Lord, that what we give, Lord, will be able to reach others, Lord, and help others, yes. Lord. So we just thank You, Lord, with gratitude and thanksgiving today, Lord. We love You and we thank You and we honor You today in our giving. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, just as you're receiving, salvation belongs to our God on His throne. Salvation belongs to the Lamb. Salvation belongs to our God on His throne. We worship the Lord and the Lamb. Forever and ever, forever and ever. Amen. Forever, amen. We worship the Lord. Now, I'm not saying this is going to happen, but somebody's going to go home and this is going to be in your head. Oh, shake it off. Shake it off. Are you ready for the Word? Are you a people that love the Word? I love the Word. I mean, I could just go down the list of Thanksgiving. I love the Lord. I love the Word. I love the Holy Spirit. And this is not less than any of them. And I love you. Amen.
We love you too.
I love you too. I love you three. Thanksgiving 2023. Wow. I was looking through some of my notes I keep, you know, in my Word. And I was looking at Thanksgiving 2015. And it just seems like yesterday. Just yesterday. Thanksgiving 2004. Like, where has it all gone? But can you be thankful for every step of the way, no matter the mountain or the valley? The consistency of our life has been a faithful God who has never left us and has always helped us. Amen. Amen.
I'm thankful. I don't know, people that don't know the Lord, at Thanksgiving, I guess they could, back in the day when they created, they could say, thank you for the Republicans. Thank you for the Democrats. This is a long time ago they say these things. I'm having some fun, come on. But Thanksgiving, the object of Thanksgiving on Thanksgiving is not stuff.
Amen. Amen.
It's the giver.
Amen.
Especially people of God, we need to look up and give God thanks. Thank you, Lord, for America. Thank you for blessing America, oh God. Thank you for protecting Israel. We pray for the peace of your people. Thank you that you are near them. While others are forsaking them, you are near. You are present. You are covenant God. Thank you, God. In every nation. You know, I've been in a lot of sanctuaries, even recently, some beautiful sanctuaries. But one thing Bethesda has that I just don't see very many places is all these flags. I hope you don't take that for granted. I wish I could take credit for it. Most of these were here when I came. Now, we've added about 12. But most of them were here. And I thank God I'm in a church that says, we love the nations. God loves the world. And then as a patriotic American, I'm also thankful to say God loves America. God loves all of America. But it's the remnant that we must be faithful to pray and declare and legislate. You know, Camilla already mentioned Tuesday night, Don, you and Father Bailey. Just so anointed. And the message was pretty tough. I mean, the message is, it's going the wrong direction fast. And there's real no solution. The government can't fix this. But what will fix this is when a nation can turn back to God.
Amen.
When Mexico can turn back to God, God will deal with the drugs and the cartels. When America can turn back to God, God can deal with abortion and child trafficking and everything else. In fact, one thing that they shared with us, America is the largest consumer of trafficking in the world. God bless America, land that I love, but America has lost its way. In America, come back to God. Can we call the prodigal America back to God? Back to the faith of our fathers. One of my favorite pictures Helen gave to us, to the church, is in the chapel. And it's a picture of our forefathers kneeling and praying as they were writing the Constitution. Is it the Constitution or the Declaration of Independence? I think it's the Constitution. As they were forming and forging forward in a brand new nation with a dream to be different than any nation has ever been before. You know, the I think it's da da, my country 'tis of the sweet land. That wasn't that originally a song to the monarchy? I think that's the one, you know. God bless the king. Da 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 da. We changed it. We changed it. America has been an experiment from the beginning. And now the only way for America to get back where we belong is for the remnant of God's people to pray and move in boldness, to get involved, to vote, to pray, to stand on the four corners and blow the horns and speak against the spirit of death. Yeah, we're a peculiar people. Yes, we are. I'm peculiar. Yes, I am. Anybody here not been in the military, you don't know those calls. Sound off.
One, two,
three, four.
Three, four.
Lift, lift, lift. Hey, a lot of church culture has been lost to a false form of freedom. It's a freedom that looks more like rebellion than freedom. It's independence that's not from fear and sin, but it's independence from having authority in your life. And that's never been God's plan, because he is Lord. He is Lord. Amen? He's Lord. And that's bigger than a king. He's the King of kings and the Lord of lords. And when Jesus is Lord, it's his way all the time. But because we know how good he is, we don't ever worry about it. Oh, if I do it that way, God will send me to Africa. That's what he said. That's what he did to you, Don, didn't he? He sent you to Africa. But it's probably the best thing that ever happened to you. Amen? Anything God does when you are yielded and humble and willing, it'll be the best thing that could ever happen. Amen. Camilla and I were on our way to California to pastor in a great church. And we got a phone call from Rick and Sandy, who've been coming back a little bit. And they said, can you come to Prairie Creek and just preach? We don't have a pastor. And I thought I was safe to say yes, because I was going somewhere. We came in here, didn't look anything like this. Just, you remember those days? This stage didn't exist. Anyway, we came in, it was dark, and there was 20 people. Justin and Deborah, Mike were among those. I think right after we came, Melinda and Quentin came. Roxy was here, that's right, Roxy. Thank God for the faithful from the beginning. Amen. But we finished, and they took us to lunch and gave us a love offering. And I said, thank you very much. And he said, can you come back next Sunday? I got a little nervous then. So let me look at my calendar. Well, I didn't have anything. So we came back. And then the Lord took that great big thumb. Anybody ever seen God's thumb? He put it right on me. He said, this is what I want you to do, son. And if you trust me, it'll be the best thing that ever happened in your life. I want to give him thanks today. It's not always been easy, but it's always been the best thing he's ever done in my life. Can you say that for your testimony on Thanksgiving? Every valley, every problem. We're going to read this scripture. I don't thank God for the sickness, but I thank him that he was with me through it, and he was giving me healing and bringing me out. So that leads me to this first scripture in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. And I was just going to read 18, but I really want to read the four points in it that I want to point out. Rejoice always. Well, come on. There's got to be a couple exceptions. Isn't there a little footnote there? Wait, do you see a little? Oh, yeah, down there it says, but not when you're going through a hard time. It doesn't say that, does it? Pray without ceasing. Well, that's a little bit more complicated because we need to sleep and eat and go to work. But what it really means is stay in the presence. Always keep your mind on him. Be communing with him. You know, prayer is not always petition. That's a part of prayer, asking. Prayer is always about the communication that's coming. Sometimes, like Camilla was talking about, it's soaking. You know that thing we do when we don't do anything? Soaking, right? We love to soak on Wednesday night. Wednesday night's one of my favorite services. And I just be honest with you, as a pastor, I really pray and prepare and I try to do my part. But then I want to let Holy Spirit do everything he wants to do on Sundays. But Wednesdays is kind of a different story. I think about it. I pray in tongues a lot. I worship. We soak. But when we go in there, it's like, what do you want to do, Lord? It's just so much fun, and there's so much freedom. And some people come in and go, what's the plan? Where's the bulletin? What's the order? We don't have one. Well, if I don't get a bulletin, I don't get a free meal at Cracker Barrel. I'm not going to your church. Rejoice always, even when the pastor tells dad jokes. Pray without ceasing. Always, Lord, you're always in my life. And you know what? When I'm really wanting to pray without ceasing, I'm going to protect what I'm bringing in. Because there's something we're about to read. I don't want to quench the Holy Spirit. Oh, Holy Spirit says, what are you doing? I don't want to be a part of that. You don't like that stuff on TV? You don't like that language? That language bothers you, Jesus? I heard the Lord tell me one time, it's rated R for a reason. And now PG-13 is just as bad. Listen, we're not being legalistic, but I'm asking you to protect the Holy Spirit. Everybody say Holy Spirit. Yeah, that's not his first name. That's his complete nature. He's holy. And if we don't protect him, it's like junk food. I'm the first one to repent that I love junk food. Camilla says, you want some salad and hummus? Nah. I'm going to eat some Fritos. You know? But that's why I look like I like and she looks like she looks. Did I say that right? I didn't. This right here is Fritos. That right there is hummus. All right. Verse 18, in everything. Everybody say everything. It's a real revelation secret here. In everything, give thanks. On Thanksgiving, I want you to be able to thank God that he is the solution for every problem. I want you to thank God that he's the author of every good thing. I want you to thank God that even if it's dry, that he will sustain you. He will uphold you. He will preserve you. Back in the day when UPS was new, by the way, I don't know if you saw the news, UPS and FedEx have merged. Did you see that? Yeah, they're going to be called Fed Up. All right. Sorry. Some of you walked right into that. Really? Really? All right. In everything, give thanks. What I was going to say is that when, believe it or not, when UPS started, it was brand new. I couldn't remember the order of the initials, SP something, whatever. Remember when it was brand new? UP, what is that? And I remember I read a scripture in Isaiah that says, God will uphold you, God will preserve you, God will sustain you. I said, that's it, UPS. Uphold, preserve, sustain. And that's honestly how I remembered UPS. Thank you for that, Pastor Stephen. You're welcome. In everything, give thanks. And if it's not clear enough, let me say, this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. So the things, these three things that is addressed in Thessalonians, rejoice always, pray without ceasing, and in everything, give thanks. Again, you can't thank God for the sickness or the sin or the problem or the tragedy or the disaster or even the death. You're not thanking him for death. You're thanking him that he is life, that he will help you through every single circumstance. I can't imagine Beverly not being able to breathe. It would be so, you know, alarming not being able to get your breath. But I breathe, I pray the breath of God, just to strength and healing into your lungs every day. And I want to tell you something. As your pastor, I empathize as best I can with you. But honestly, I can't feel everything you feel. But I can take you to someone who does. He feels everything. And he is ever, forever interceding for us. He's praying for you right now. He's praying for your families. He's praying. Thanksgiving for some people is very hard because it is a family time. I'm thinking of you, Roxy, losing your father and praying his grace. And years ago, losing your husband, I pray his grace over you, that you can be thankful in all of your circumstances because he is with you. He loves you. He loves you. My son Christian is coming home today. Yeah. Oh, I don't want to cry, but I'm thankful. He lives far away. We never thought when he went to California, he wouldn't come back. He went singing, California, here I come. And I'm saying, give him up. Give him up in Jesus' name. But Christian's coming home. We're going to pick him up tonight. Flies in at about 9:00. And we're going to be together, and I'm so thankful. But again, I realize that there are families that are broken, that are hurt. Some of you are estranged from your children, members of your family. And the thought of being together for some people is painful. They don't want to do it. They want to avoid it at all costs. I just want to tell you that's not God's plan for us. Amen? He designed our family to be a fellowship of love and honor and respect. And the enemy has so devastated our families. The two targets that the enemy has made his main targets are the two institutions that God created, the family and the church. God created the family, and he created the church. And we have holidays that celebrate those, like Easter, Christmas. Oh, you remember Christmas is about Jesus. I just wondered. Oh, yeah, that's right. It started as Christmas. And then verse 19, I'm going to come back to this in a few minutes. It says, put that up for me. After it says rejoice and pray and give thanks, in verse 19, it just says something that seems like, why'd you throw that in there for? And do not quench the Spirit. I'm going to come back to that because it's pretty powerful, okay? Romans 8:28, I just want to read this scripture. And this is from the Amplified. And we know with great confidence. Everybody say with great confidence. Don't just know it in your head and just kind of go, yeah, that's what my mom believed. That's what my friends believe. This needs to be what you know with great confidence that God, who is deeply concerned about us, causes all things to work together as a plan for good for those who love God. You know, what I thought about was this modern GPS. Sometimes it wants to take me away. I really don't want to go. Like, I don't want to go over there. But the other day, it wanted me to go to Loop 49. I'm going down 69. So if you don't do the plan, what does your GPS do? Rerouting until it can figure out where you are. And then it gives you a new plan to get to the same destination. Are you following? Life throws things at us and we get knocked off of our path, get knocked down, but we get up and we give thanks and we pray without ceasing and we rejoice at all times because God loves us and he's going to work things together as a plan for good, for those who love, to those who are called according to his plan and purpose. That's what it is to be a follower of Jesus. I'm following Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. It was a song that I sang as a little boy and gave my life to Jesus Christ. No turning back. Now at 64 years old, I'm not turning back. Never will, in Jesus' name. Come on, give me an amen on that. You're never going to turn back. I love that song from United Pursuit. I'm never going back. I made up my mind. It's too high. I'm never going back. I think about I don't know if you think this way, but every once in a while I think, you know, if when I was in Tulsa, if I wouldn't have answered the phone the day that Camilla's father called me, my whole life would have been different. I never would have come down to Tyler, Texas, sang on the very first Sunday night I was there with a little girl, a little young, pretty girl named Camilla. I sang with her the first time I was there. And I called my mama maybe 2 weeks later and said, Mom, I met the girl I'm going to marry. And when I told Camilla, she said, you're crazy. Not really. I was smart enough to not tell her. Or she would have told me I was crazy. James 1:17. Just some good scriptures. This is from the Message. I really liked it. You know every good and perfect gift, right? But the Message says every desirable and beneficial gift comes out of heaven. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. You see, there's reasons that we sing these songs. They're right out of the heart of God and the word of the Lord. The gifts are, this is why I really wrote this passage. The gifts are rivers of light cascading down from the Father of light. Goes on to say, in whom there is no shifting shadow. So good. If you read all the chapter 1 of James, it talks about living in darkness, and then contrast that the God of heaven is the Father of light. We live in the light as he is in the light. Okay, Luke 11. This is a good scripture. If you then, though you are evil. Now, he's really not talking to the born again, but he was talking to the religious. If you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven, remember where every good and perfect, desirable and beneficial gift come from? How much more will your Father in heaven give? Now in Luke, it's different. Other gospel passage says good gifts. But in Luke, it's more specific. And it says, how much will your Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? Now, depending on what camp you're in, is the verse you'll choose to read. If you don't want to talk about Holy Spirit, you'll just talk about good gifts. But if you really want the revelation of what the Father wants to give you, his very best gift, it comes in a person. Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit. Amen. Acts 19, verse 2. Unfortunately, this is a scenario that is still so true today. He asked them, this is as they were going out and beginning to preach the gospel. They'd left Jerusalem and they were going out. And they met some believers and they say to them, did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed on Jesus as the Christ? And they said, no. We have not even heard that there is a Holy Spirit. So guess what? We got a job to do. We got something to do. We got to tell people about the Holy Spirit. You remember our friend Caleb that was here, Caleb and Kelsey? We're going to be supporting them. They have college campus ministry in the Raleigh area for Duke and North Carolina State and North Carolina. Ooh, I'm going to go see them because that's hometown town for me. But Caleb said to me one time, sitting across the table, we were talking, he said, you're a Holy Spirit guy. And I felt like opening my shirt and revealing, yes, I am. I am Holy Spirit guy. I am. I love Holy Spirit. And it took me a little while to get that freedom. For whatever reason, in my background, man, it was easy to love God and easy to love Jesus, but Holy Spirit was a thing, like a tool, the Holy Spirit. I don't know if you've noticed this like I have, but there's been a new revelation of Holy Spirit as a person. And as a result, we start talking about Holy Spirit different. In our description, it's not the Holy Spirit. It can be. I'm not criticizing that. But the revelation is Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, you. Or you could say, the Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. It doesn't work quite the same. Are you following me? It sounds better, but it is better. Because Holy Spirit is part of that triune nature of God. And it's the part, now don't get me in trouble here, but it's the part that God was always working toward in the plan of salvation. Religion stops with Jesus many times. God sent his son. But Jesus himself said, John said of Jesus, and he, Jesus, after he does what he's going to do, will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is described in the Gospels as the gift of the Father, and it could only be given because of the obedience and the sacrifice of the Son. It all works together. But Jesus said to his disciples, do not let your hearts be troubled. They were really really upset because Jesus had told them, I'm about to leave. So what did he say to them? He said something that's historical. He said to these men that had walked with the Savior, the Messiah, he said, it's going to be better for you when I leave. What? No way! I'm just hoping Camilla never believes that about me. You guys are way too serious. I've got to jump in there once in a while just to make sure you're not sleeping on me. And he said to the disciples, no, it's going to be better for you because I'm going to the Father. And whatever you ask in my name, I will do. And the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of truth, will be in you. And he will be with you. And he will never leave you. And he will never forsake you. You've got the best gift that the Father has been waiting to give. And you can have it all. All of it. Holy Spirit. I'm a Holy Spirit guy. Holy Spirit is in me. So, they said, we've not even heard there is a Holy Spirit. So I put this little thought. Let's talk about Holy Spirit. And for some people, we're going to give them something to talk about. You want to talk about what? I want to talk about Holy Spirit. You know what I love about the Holy Spirit? Is what I talk about is what he means to me. How I know him and experience him. His presence, all that he's done for me, it's just like testimony time. Here's what Holy Spirit's done in my life. And I really do. I really feel bad for people that go, I never even heard of the Holy Spirit. Or, well, yeah, I mean, I know they said in the name of the Father and the Son, oh, I was baptized, and then Father, Son, the Holy Spirit, but I never really, what does that mean? So, we're going to talk about the Holy Spirit. Now I'm going to go back to that one little verse in 1 Thessalonians 5. Rejoice, pray, give thanks. And it says, do not quench the Spirit. Now, that's the way it reads. But I went to look into what that means. What does it mean to quench the Spirit? And I found two versions that I really like that kind of help you see it. So from a version called the Expanded Bible, it says, do not hold back the work of stifle, quench, extinguish the Holy Spirit. So I want to just tell you that you're never going to be able to fully rejoice without Holy Spirit. You're not really going to be able to go into the depths of intercession and praise and worship and prayer without Holy Spirit. You're not really going to be able to give thanks in a hard, tough season without Holy Spirit. And if you try to, you're going to stifle, quench, and hinder the Holy Spirit's work that he wants to accomplish in our lives. Amen. So the easy, I'm going to find this one. I really like this. It's called Easy to Read Version. Anybody ever heard of that? The Easy to Read Version says, don't stop the work of the Holy Spirit. Ooh, this kind of partners with what Jesus said. There's one thing that will not be forgiven. If you blaspheme the Holy Spirit. And that word blaspheme is not necessarily not believing in, but hindering, quenching, stifling what the Holy Spirit's doing, or denying him altogether, or even worse, saying that what he's doing is from the devil. Ooh, that's just, ooh, that's a tough one. Now, I want to go on record to say, I believe God will forgive anything that we repent from. Amen, that's just how good he is. But the problem with blasphemy is you never change your mind. And if you go to meet the Lord with that in your heart, you're in a bad place. Probably one of the gravest sins of the church today is quenching the Spirit. We don't want to do that, amen? We want to say, Holy Spirit, come. Holy Spirit, move. Holy Spirit, have your way. I want to tell you, pastors like me aren't pastors because we're the most qualified. I'd like to lift up both hands and say, I believe I'm here because I want to be the most yielded. That when God says, can I trust somebody that will take a position of serving and ministering, that I can trust to let me do what I want to do. And I'm saying, yes, you can. You can do what you want to do. And lately I've been seeing some things that he wants to do, things that he wants to just take over. I like to call it Holy Ghost hijack. He just comes in and says, we're going this way. And we're a people, I believe, I really do. I'm looking around right now. I don't think there's anybody in this room right now. There's not anyone in this room. Really, I mean this from my heart. I'm looking around. I don't see anybody. Well, hold on, wait just a minute. I don't see anybody in this room that doesn't want Holy Spirit to move, for Holy Spirit to come, you know? And you all have passed the test over and over, if you're still here, to be in a peculiar place, to be in a place that goes, salvation belongs to the Lord on the throne, you know? That sounds like a beer drinking song, doesn't it? Salvation belongs to the Lord. Hoy, ho, and Mirio, whatever these pirates say. Arr. I just write them like he gives them to me. I told the worship team today, I said, my goal is to be able to write a song that comes from heaven that one day when we go back, we can all say, we were singing that down there. I mean, I don't know how this could ever happen. I still would love to get the anointing to hear the songs that David wrote, the Psalms. You know, those Psalms that we read, most of them were songs. The Lord is my shepherd. Okay, I'm going to get silly. I'm not going to do that. It's silly. This is when Camilla starts getting embarrassed. And I start feeling her praying against me, by the way. Stop it. Don't pray against me. So we're talking about the Holy Spirit. And this scripture says, do not stop the work of the Holy Spirit. We're about to go to 1 Corinthians, where Paul was writing, giving instructions to a new breed of believers that had been filled with the Holy Spirit. And they were wild. Paul had to get in there and say, okay, hold on. We're not getting a whole lot done. Y'all are so excited about this new gift. Y'all praying in tongues all the time. Nobody knows what you're doing. Nobody knows what you mean. So let's get this in order. But I love the way that Bill Johnson really got the revelation and helped us to see that Paul was not trying to stop them, because he said, let everything be done. He wasn't saying, stop doing it. He said, let it all be done, but let's do it in heaven's order. Do it the way God designed it, to edify the church. I mean, he says when we're together, we should desire to prophesy and build one another up. We're going to read some of that. But you know, I laugh about Holy Spirit sometimes when religious people go, oh, we don't want to do all that. We'll scare people away. Those are the same people that are heading down the road to watch the Rocky Horror Show. That's the only thing I could think of. It's probably not even scary, is it? No. Texas Chainsaw Massacre, you know? Oh, I don't want to offend them with the Holy Spirit. And they're in there going, ring, ring, ring. Come on. You're not going to win that argument with me. The people want the fear of the Lord. The counterfeit fear that the world gives them, that gives them a little bit of a tingle or a high. I don't even like it. I have to admit, I don't like it. I don't like to be scared. Camilla scared me this morning. I walked into the room not expecting. She was just standing there. And I went, whoa! She looked at me, what? I said, I wasn't expecting. I was thinking to myself, I came into the church the other day. It was dark. And I'm not trying to be cheap, but I pretty much know my way around. I think I'm not going to turn all the lights on. I'm just going to walk through the church. And I'm walking down that one hall, Justin, the children's hallway. It's dark. And I while I was walking, you know, I kind of kept my hands because I didn't bump into the wall, you know. You know how you do in the dark. And I'm thinking, if somebody jumped out right now, I would have a heart attack. If somebody was in here and just went, hey, I would have a heart attack. And about the time I was thinking about having a heart attack, I went, boom, right into the door. Boom, ah! Man, that came fast. I don't like to be scared. But what I love the fear of the Lord, the awe of God. I mean, there are things that he does. Wow. But it doesn't leave you with death. It leaves you with life. Okay. Let's talk about the work of the Holy Spirit. I love what Holy Spirit does. So here's where we're going to go to 1 Corinthians. I told you we were going to look. There are different kinds of spiritual gifts, but the same Spirit is the source of them all. Everybody say the same Spirit. And you know his name, Holy Spirit. He's the one that is the source. The source of it all. A spiritual gift is given to each of us so we can help each other. So here I want to tell you at Bethesda, you are being trained and equipped and empowered to receive the gift that God has for you to serve the Lord. We could get over to Ephesians and talk about for the building and the equipping and the training of the saints for the works of service. That's what this is. The Spirit is given. And I love that no one's left out. Ask and you shall receive. Sometimes we think of that only with salvation. But this is about wanting to move in the Holy Spirit, wanting to have more. So every one of us can have a gift. But notice from the very beginning, the gift is not for you to go, look at what I can do. Hello. That's why tongues sometimes gets us in trouble. Because if your motive is to show out, then you might as well just be quiet. But if you're worshiping, come on. Keep going. Or, you know, I don't have an Assembly of God background. I came mostly from Baptist to a charismatic, so my introduction to the praying in tongues and praying in the Holy Spirit was not so much for the interpretation, but that's real. And in many services, including here, if somebody stood up and prayed out in tongues, we would wait. Because scripturally, if you are prophesying through tongues, there should be an interpretation. But again, Paul goes on to say that we don't have to pray in tongues in order to prophesy. We can just prophesy. And we love to do that too. But then some people have said to us at Bethesda, I don't really like it when y'all pray in tongues over the microphone. Where's the interpretation? Well, again, it's the intention. Are you praying to the Lord? Is it prayer language of worship and praise and maybe even intercession? Or is it prophetic in nature? If the motivation is prophetic, yes, there should be an interpretation. Are we together? We just need to look at the word, and do it the way the word tells us to do it. It's amazing that the same scripture in James said he's the God of light, that there are in him are no shifting shadow. He doesn't change. Thou changest not, thy compassions, they fail not. These are eternal realities, principles, and truths. He doesn't change. So what he's put in his word is what he wants. You know, we're praying for Bishop Strickland. God bless Bishop Strickland. We were watching a little bit and finding out more. The reason that he's been fired is because he's speaking up. And he's saying, I believe the Bible. That's bottom line. I believe the Bible is not to be modified by culture. But culture is to be transformed by the Bible. And when we try to modify culture and churches say, well, I think, you know, let's just go ahead and love the homosexuals and let them come in and tell them, yeah, you're fine. You are not loving them, telling them they're fine, because the Bible says they're not. But we are going to love them. You know, I think we're going to go here in just a minute about love. But the truth is always partnering with love. If you don't partner the truth with love, then it's half truth. Because it's entwined with judgment. But when we entwine it with God's mercy and grace and love, and we speak the truth, then the Holy Spirit, that's what he'll do. It'll go into their heart and it'll bring back. It'll bring back a result that God wants. So to one person, the Spirit gives the ability to give wise advice. Again, this is a New Living Translation. If you read this in a more traditional, spirit of wisdom. To another, the Spirit gives a message of special knowledge, the word of knowledge. The Spirit, same Spirit gives great faith. Boy, I like that gift, you know, to look in, like honestly, somebody like Winston Churchill. I believe God anointed him with great faith to become a wartime leader that led his nation through the darkest hour. We would be speaking German today. Don't tell me God can't use one person. And I'm going to lift my other finger and say, God, use me. Come on, just lift up that finger. Say, God, use me. Remember that old song, if you can use me, if you can, anyone, if you, yeah, that one. I don't got it. Help me, Lord. The same Spirit gives great faith, and to someone else, one Spirit gives gift of healing. You know, again, I don't know that I have the gift of healing. I believe in healing and I pray for healing. But there are some people that if you're asking, Holy Spirit will give you a gift. And I want to know when you have that gift, because I will ask you to come up and help pray for people and release your gift. We believe in that. Amen. But I'm going somewhere with this. He gives a person power to perform miracles. He gives another person the ability to prophesy. He gives someone the ability to discern whether a message is from the Spirit of God or from another spirit. My son Cameron, my oldest son, when he was a little boy, he said, Daddy, I think God's given me the gift of discernments. That's what he said, discernments. We still laugh and celebrate that because he does have that gift. He can see right through it. And sometimes he doesn't know what to do with it, you know, when you can see right through into the motivation of something. Woo, that's a good gift. And it's important. We need that in the kingdom. Amen? Still another is given the ability to speak in unknown languages. And I like, speak in tongues, speak in the angel, languages of heaven. But again, if you really want to get down to it, on the day of Pentecost, the gift that came, maybe some of them were praying in tongues as we understand it. But the ones that God anointed to pray in other languages that they did not know was a witness to those that had come into Jerusalem from other nations. And they were praising God in their own languages. Now, I've heard this preached different ways, and I could believe all of it. I remember T.L. Osborne said they were probably speaking in tongues, but the Holy Spirit allowed them to hear their own language. Well, that could have been too. But I know that, what's the guy that went into Africa, the famous Christian? Livingston, right? Livingston? Is that right? Yeah. He went in and he had that gift that he would begin to talk to the natives and God would give him their tongue. Yeah. I'd just like to be able to speak Spanish, Lord. I think that'd be great. This is kind of funny. Okay, you guys know me too well, but can anybody give me 5 minutes? Okay, that's all I needed. I saw three hands. Justin, I saw three hands. That's good. It's 15 minutes. Praise the Lord. Quit praying against me. Okay. Look at verse 11. It is the one and only Spirit who distributes all of these gifts. He alone decides which gift each person should have. So we're not going to be jealous. We're not going to be competitive. We're going to ask and yield and say, God, I'll take whatever you want me to have. And then what he gives us, we're going to use. Amen? We're going to use. I got the gift of discernments. With healing in their hands. Amen? All right, look at 1 Corinthians a little further down in verse 28. This is out of the New King James. And God has appointed these in the church. First apostles, second prophets, third teachers, after that miracles, then gifts of healings. Now it's interesting, Paul wrote this and he also wrote Ephesians, prophets, what we call fivefold ministry. But this is a different letter from the same Holy Spirit inspiring Paul to write. First apostles, second prophets, third teachers, after that miracles. Ooh, I want to be in that church. Gifts of healing, helps, administrations. We're having a meeting after church, Camilla, for the gift of helps. Ministry gifts of serving. administration, and varieties of tongues. Now, I want you to see this in the King James and see how the spirit of religion can twist what Paul meant. Are all apostles? Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Are all workers of miracles? Do all have the gifts of healing? Do all speak with tongues? Do all interpret? And the answer is no. So then, I don't want to speak in tongues. I don't want to prophesy. That's the conclusion when you see it in the wrong way. And of all places in the message, I found the best way or an easy way to understand this. So here we go. Verse 29 in the message. It's obvious by now, isn't it, that Christ's church is a complete body and not a gigantic one-dimensional part. Isn't that great? It's not all apostle, not all prophet, not all miracle worker, not all healer, not all prayer in tongues, not all interpreter of tongues. Do you see it's different, right? It's basically saying it's more than one dimension. The body of Christ is multifaceted with the gifts in operation. Amen? That's the place I want to be. When the gifts are all moving, the apostles and prophets and pastors and teachers and evangelists and gifts of healing and helps and administration and speaking in tongues, word of knowledge, I want it all. If it's in the word, I want it in the church. I also want to thank God. Don, I think you can relate to this. It's wonderful to be in a church that can't fire you. You didn't hire me, and you can't fire me. Now, if you want to go to a church that votes and votes out their pastor when they don't like what he says, then see you later. But that doesn't mean that I can't be corrected, okay? That's not what that means. I hope I don't have to be corrected, but I know that somebody has a really good handle on that in my life. Holy Spirit 2, right there. 1 Corinthians 12:31 in the Amplified, but earnestly desire and zealously cultivate the greatest and best gifts and graces, the higher gifts and the choicest graces. And here it goes. Here's what I want you to see. Here's where we're going with this. And yet, right out of this chapter about the gifts, we shift into a chapter we know as the love chapter, and we've separated it as if somehow it's not connected. But I'm here to tell you today, it is so completely connected that you cannot have one without the other in the kingdom. So he goes on to say, yet well, I will show you a still more excellent way, one that is better by far than anything we've just talked about, and the highest of them all. Everybody say it with me. Love. Love. If I'm not going to read the last verse in chapter 13, but it says, and now these three remain. Faith, hope, love, and the greatest of them. Make no mistake. When I was in California, we were in a great service with a great preacher. We sat down to eat. And we were talking, and I said, what about the scripture that says the greatest is love? He said, well, the greatest is really faith on the earth. The greatest thing for us now is faith. That's absurd. If you don't have love, your faith means nothing. So let's go back and see what the beginning of chapter 13. I wrote this, the way of Holy Spirit is love. 1 Corinthians 13, just verse 1 and 2. We're almost finished. If I could speak in the languages of earth and angels, but didn't love others, I would only be a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. Come on. This is in the Word. If you're not walking in love, your gift means nothing. And in fact, I like to go a little further. Say your gift is probably doing more harm than good because you're partnering with a religious spirit. Didn't I prophesy in your name, Jesus? Didn't we do all these things? And he said, I never knew you. There was no love in your heart, even though you had a gift. That's pretty strong. But did it happen? Oh, yeah. Is it going to happen? I hope not, but probably. Not to you. Not one person in this room in the name of Jesus is going to have that conversation with the Lord. Amen. If I had the gift of prophecy, verse 2. If I understood all of God's secret plans and possessed all knowledge. I mean, we got so many people puffed up with knowledge. They get up in the pulpits and they just full of knowledge. And everybody goes, they're so smart. But they lack love. What does God say about that? If I had such faith that I can move mountains. I mean, you're doing something. I remember sitting with a man of God talking about Jim Baker. You know the story of Jim Baker. And I said, why did God let him do all the things he did when he was living in sin? And I got the best answer I've ever heard on that question. Because God loves the sheep. Sometimes the vessels aren't what he wants them to be, but sometimes if the word goes out, he'll anoint it. But don't you be mistaken. There will come a day that your sin will find you out. You don't want to walk in any form of darkness. You want to live in the light as he is in the light. Amen? And living in the light is another way of saying living in his love. God is love. God is light, and in him is no darkness. God is love. If you could move mountains but didn't love others, it would be nothing. Or I would be nothing. Then Jesus, in Luke chapter 6, he speaks this word. A good tree can't produce bad fruit. And a bad tree can't produce good fruit. A tree is identified by its fruit. Figs are never gathered from thorn bushes, and grapes are not picked from bramble bushes. So the reason I feel like the Lord highlighted this to me is that many times we want to put love over into the area of fruit and separate it from gifts, but actually it's the bridge that develops and produces the fruit and activates and operates the gifts. Love is the central piece. And when love is missing, you don't have the fruit or the gifts. Not really. But you might be anointed. You might be gifted. There's people in ministry that are gifted, but they're not loving. And they're missing it. They're missing it. So I want to go over to what we know as the fruit of the Spirit chapter in Galatians chapter 5. And I remember, this could have been a whole message, but I'm just going to just give you my highlights from a message that I've preached many times and a revelation. Actually, I believe, so I feel maybe like Paul. This is from me. This is I, not the Lord. But I really believe this is true. I do. I believe that Galatians is talking about the kind of fruit that the Holy Spirit produces. And the fruit is love. Now, the way it's written and transcribed, it looks like there are all these different individual fruit. Because fruit is plural and singular, right? It's fruit. Hey, look at all that fruit. I want a piece of fruit. It's kind of weird in English, right? But the fruit of the Holy Spirit is love. And I believe in the original language, that was the intention, the fruit of the Holy Spirit, the way of the Holy Spirit, what the Holy Spirit produces, because it can't produce anything else but love. And I got this out of a study Bible, and I've always loved it. As it goes on and say, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Okay? Now, I think it's up here. Can you put it up there, what I've got written? Joy is love's pleasure. So, you know, many times we think of the fruit of the Spirit, we might picture an apple, right? Maybe you do. But I want you to picture an orange. And I want you to see that that fruit is love. But as you peel it open, there's joy in love. Joy is love's pleasure. Peace, another peace of the fruit, is love's composure. Where do you stay, joy?
I stay in peace.
Patience. Oh, this one's kind of lacking in some of us. Is love's perseverance. Kindness is love's conduct. I have to remind myself of that often. I really do. Lord, help me to be kind to people that are unkind. It's easy to be kind to people that are kind, but be kind to people that are not kind. That's the fruit of the Spirit, love, to be kind to everyone. Goodness is love's character. It's who I am. It's who God is. His character is goodness. His glory is the fullness of his goodness on display. Faithfulness is love's confidence. Now, some versions say faith, but it works together. Faith or faithful. Faith-filled, faithful, faith is love's confidence. From that spirit of faith, love produces the confidence. What does it say in Hebrews chapter 11? Faith is the evidence of things not seen. It's the, what's the next word? It's the what? Substance of things hoped for. Faithfulness is love's confidence. Gentleness is love's tenderness. You know, we have a puppy, and she can get really wild, really excited. I mean, rough, jumping, still biting, you know, snipping and biting. But my favorite times with her is when she's kind of settled down, and she's so sweet. Just kissing on her and loving on her, and I talk real soft to her. You know, Camille talks about talking to our grandson. You're going to be appointed and anointed. I say to my dog, you're just the sweetest little girl. I just love you so much. You're such a good girl. There's a country song by Billy Currington. It's called Love Me Like My Dog Does. It's really a play on words because he's complaining that my dog never complains. He's always happy to see me. He eats anything I give him. Right? And there's some things in there that are not good. I don't want you to necessarily listen to it, but I've heard it before. But I think in that context, God, let me be as gentle with others as I am with my puppy. Help me to be loving. Love or gentleness is love's tenderness.
Well, I'm a man. I don't get tender.
You better get tender. If you're going to be really a person of love, you need to have a tender heart, right? Some of the best advice I was given as a young minister, getting my feelings hurt a lot. Somebody came up to me and said, you know, if you're going to make it in ministry, you're going to have to be tough-skinned and tender-hearted. Tough-skinned, tender-hearted. Amen? God, let your love make me tough-skinned and tender-hearted so I can be gentle. And self-control is love's instruction. If you really read the New Testament in the context of how we are governed, we are not governed by the law anymore. And Paul really argued this because so many religious people got upset with him. They said, wait a minute, we got to keep the law. He said, no, God put his law in our hearts. And now in relationship with him and the activation of Holy Spirit, the Spirit of truth, speaking into our life and the word that they didn't even have altogether at that time. But we have it, the written word, the New Testament that we can look into and read. All these things that we have is how Holy Spirit will govern us. And that's true freedom. Is to know that the Holy Spirit is going to lead us into truth. Jesus, when he taught us to pray, said, when you pray, lead us not into temptation, deliver us from evil. Amen? So this message today at Thanksgiving is the gratitude and the thankfulness that we have that Holy Spirit is in our lives. Amen? And that he, by partnering with Holy Spirit as a person, we can always rejoice. We can always pray. We can always be thankful because we're not going to quench the Holy Spirit. Can somebody say amen? Amen. All right, I've got a great song that I'm going to start, and then
just a little bit in the song, I'm going to just pray for you and we'll be finished. We're having that meeting directly after church and in the hub. So it is an invitation. Camilla and Joy have been praying over this, and they put together people that are currently actively serving, and we're going to start with you. But I want to tell you that if Holy Spirit begins to put it in your heart and you're not in this meeting today, I want you to know that our arms are reached out saying, God, multiply and bring everyone that you want into acts of serving. Amen? But that's where we're going right after this service. This song's called Come Holy Spirit, and I just want you to hear it for a moment. Just close your eyes and just say, Holy Spirit, we invite you to come into every area of our life, to fill us completely, to lead us and guide us. Come in, Holy Spirit. Just let us be swept away in your presence, in your glory. Those of you that are watching online, I hope you can hear this. We want to feel your presence right where we are, because you are with us. I want to be undone. Holy Spirit, come in like a flood. Swept away. Come, everybody say come. The Spirit and the Bride say come.
I just want to invite our ministry team to come forward, and maybe you're here today and you're like, this Holy Spirit thing is new to me, but I think I want this and I want more of it. Our team is just going to pray with you just for the impartation, filling of the Holy Spirit. Maybe you don't have your prayer language yet and you've been really wanting that. Just let us pray with you. Maybe you just need that fresh touch, fresh impartation of Holy Spirit. It's here for you today. And I've been kind of thinking, all the while Stephen has been preaching and acting like I don't like it. I love it. I had a dream last Monday morning, and in my dream, it was kind of ongoing. It was a dream that I would dream, and I stopped dreaming, and then I was dreaming it again. And in the dream, I was laughing. I was getting so tickled, and I was laughing so hard. And when I woke up, I was refreshed because I had laughed pretty much all night long in the joy. And then we had a very heavy week, meetings that we were in and things that we were praying over. It was very heavy. And I had told Joy about my dream, and she's like, I've been thinking about that dream all week. And I just know we need the joy. So the Lord, you know, he's imparting and just releasing a refreshing and a joy over us that is our strength. I want to just, you can just stand today and just come forward for letting us just pray over you and let this team just release to you. Go ahead and stand up. Father, we love you in this place. And we thank you, Lord, for the joy that is our strength. The joy is not of our happenings. It comes from you today. the joy is sustainable. That joy is our strength. Holy Spirit, we thank you that you have everything we need, and we need everything you have. And so we just receive it all, every one of us, Lord, across the room. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you for filling us up with you. All of you today, all of you, all of you, all of you. Your great love, your great grace. Fill us up today. She's just going to release a prayer out over the church.
Holy Spirit, Heavenly Father, I want to thank you for all that you've done in every single person in this church's life, as in household, family, etc. I want to ask you, though, to not help these people, not let the sorrow of sin and inflict their lives. I want the pain in physical and mental to be removed. I want them to know that they were loved by you. I pray that everybody in this room has a wonderful Thanksgiving, and remember that you are the reason we have to be thankful. In Jesus' name, amen.
That's an awesome prayer. Thank you for coming up and sharing that. Thank you. Holy Spirit, come.
When Kimmy first came to the church, she said, "I like that church." She told her mom and dad, "I like that church." And they said she was smiling all the time. You still have the same joy, don't you, Kimmy? Even though there's been some tough things that have happened. And that prayer is so sincere. I receive that, don't you? From a young lady that's lost a daddy, to say, have a happy Thanksgiving and have gratitude in your heart for all that Jesus has done for us. Thank you so much.
Amen. Thank you, Holy Spirit.